Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another Ask Ian Q&A video on Forgotten Weapons. I'm Ian, of course, and today our question comes from Ryan on Patreon, and Ryan asks, why do more rifles not have captive takedown pins? It seems that if someone is developing a rifle from the ground up, there's almost no drawback to captive pins, especially if the rifle is going to be widely fielded. So is there some hidden cost? The answer is, I don't know that it's necessarily a hidden cost, but there is definitely a cost, especially an engineering cost, to having captive takedown pins. And I think it is largely involved in the type of fabrication of the rest of the gun, because there are some situations where captive takedown pins are actually not that difficult to integrate, and there are some situations where they can be very difficult to integrate. So let's go over to the disassembly table and let's take a look at a couple examples of rifles that do and don't have captive pins and see why they do or don't have them. I think the best example people probably have of captive pins being a thing and being helpful is the AR-15. So let's start there. Just gonna start with my rear captive pin here. Now let's first consider what's required to prevent that pin coming out. Well, there has to be some sort of detent to keep me from just pulling the pin all the way out. And so if we look at the side of the pin here, you can see that there's a little track milled in the pin. And then we have this feature on the lower receiver itself that has a spring back here and a detent in the front. And what's important to point out here is that in order for this to work, you have to have a way to install the detent and to prevent the detent from coming out the front of this hole. So this is some of the engineering cost of having captive pins. First off, we have to make arrangements to have a hole that we can access, in this case, from the back. So this is a 2-diameter hole. It's going to be a larger diameter here until it gets up really close to the front, and then it's going to get slightly narrower so that you can put a little bit of a neck on your detent. So you put the detent pin in the back and it can only protrude out a certain distance so that it puts a reasonable stable amount of tension on the pin itself. This is like, I don't know if I would call this a hidden cost, but it is definitely an additional engineering cost to developing, well, to installing, or to having a feature like captive pins. Now, this is still an AR-15, right? So it should be the same, and yet the KP-15, the receiver for the What Would Stoner Do rifles, this does not have captive pins. Despite the fact, I mean, there's some difference in the architecture back here that could explain it, but there's no difference up in the front, right? So why doesn't this have a captive pin? Well, the answer is we have a different material that we're working from here. And in aluminum, you can drill a little tiny hole in the front of this aluminum feature, and that's not a problem. But polymer is not as strong. And if you drill a little tiny hole into a thin piece of polymer, you're very much creating a weak point. And so rather than risk having breakage on the parts, you will find, especially when manufacturers are working with polymer, that it may not be feasible, just given the architecture of the part, to have a hole for a pin and a detent, or a spring and a detent pin, to give you a captive pin. And you'll see that in other polymer receivers as well. So if we look at the Steyr AUG here, we have a pin that's held in place by basically part in the fire control group, but the pin itself is not captive. Why? Well, because you've got a polymer shell here with, you'd have to drill a hole. You could, in fact, drill a hole from the back to put in a pin and a spring to retain the takedown pin, and yet you would create a thin weak point in the receiver back here. So again, no retention on that pin. But what if we go look at HK? Surely HK, it's a widely fielded military rifle, been used for many decades. It's made out of metal. Polymer shouldn't be an issue here. So why does HK not have captive pins? Well, this may be metal, but it's stamped sheet metal. There's no space in this part to have a retention mechanism for that pin. Now, one thing you could do is the Swiss solution. I apologize, I don't have a SIG 550 here to show you, but we do have a little bit of video footage from disassembling one. SIG opted to use pins that have their own built-in retention mechanism, which is cool and clever, but that's also just begging for something to go wrong with the pin. A little bit of dirt, a little bit of rust, and pretty soon you've got a pin that's can be maybe solidly jammed in the rifle. And now, is the benefit of having a captive takedown pin, which is not really, well, it's certainly not necessary, it's just convenient, is that worth the potential risk of, now I can't disassemble this rifle because the pin has malfunctioned? Like, do you, I mean, how typically Swiss is it, perhaps, to design a pin that is capable of malfunctioning? Say what you want about HK, but that pin really isn't going to malfunction. So what we fundamentally see here is that there are structural requirements in the parts that have an impact on whether or not you can have captive pins. Now, that being said, let's take a look at a couple cool examples of rifles that do have captive pins despite having, say, polymer furniture on them. A good example here would be the VHS-2, or as it's sold in the US, the Springfield Hellion. This, like, oh, plastic furniture, plastic lower, plastic handguard, and yet that pin is captive. So how do they do that? Well, they have actually designed what's sort of a rivet-like part that is screwed here. It's two parts screwed together into the plastic, and this part itself retains the captive mechanism to hold the pin in place. So that, this may not seem like a lot of cost, but it is a non-trivial cost. So your pin is now proprietary. This comprises two separate pieces that attach together, and you've got, I think, three of them on the rifle total. So you've got six more components going into the gun now. And if you're trying to manufacture this in large numbers, well, now you've got like a couple additional parts that can act as a choke point to overall rifle production. You run short of these little doodles and your whole production line will shut down until you can get more of them. So it's a cool solution here. I like it, but it's not something that is free of cost. Just to play devil's advocate, here's an example of a design that does have the problems that I elaborated earlier and yet has captive pins anyway. So this is an MDRX, and if I punch out this front pin, you'll see, pin's captive, and it's got that AR style of groove milled into the pin. And that means there's a spring and a detent in here. Well, what they did was bulk up the polymer right where the pin goes through, and then they just went ahead and drilled a hole in it anyway, and they're accessing it through the pin. So if I push this in, you can see there's a little tiny hole drilled in the pin that will allow you to disassemble it by opening it to here, putting a very small punch through to depress the spring and detent behind, and then pull the pin out. So they've gone ahead and done exactly what I said wasn't a good idea on the What Would Stoner receiver, the KP-15 receivers, but they, well, and they've just simply taken a different approach to what's viable. They have been able to increase the amount of polymer here, but this is a weak point. So perhaps this is a weak point in an area that's not getting a lot of force put on it that they don't think is prone to breakage. And they're willing to accept having a couple extra parts, having to drill an extra hole in each of the pins in order to give that functionality. There you go, Ryan. I hope that answered your question sufficiently. I think captive pins are definitely a nice feature to have when they're feasible. Of course, if you don't have captive pins, you can always take the pin out and then take the piece off and put the pin right back in it, or do the HK sort of thing and have a specific pre-built hole in the stock to hold them, I suppose, if you don't want to put them back where they came from. At any rate, as we can see, it's not always that super simple and feasible to add them into a design. Anyway, if you would like to have your question answered in a format like this on video, sign up on either Patreon or Utreon. That is where I take questions for these videos. We have running threads each month on both platforms for questions like this. Hopefully you enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching.